Well, ladies and gentlemen, welcome back to the second game of the series here between the sides of 4ASC and, of course, Ninjas in Pyjamas. And, well, we can announce spoilers. I want for the spoilers. If you don't want to know what's going on between the sides of Alliance and PR, do close your ears and your eyes. But I'm sure if you're following any kind of social media outlet, you will know that, indeed, Alliance are out. They did lose that first game to PR, which means now that we know who's won in this group in terms of, we know the positions. It is, of course, going to be Ninjas in Pyjamas in second place. 4ASC will be first, regardless of the outcome of this game and the game that's still being played over on the other stream. So maybe we'll see a little bit of fun. I was going to say we might see some fun. It looks like it's not the case. We're seeing Les Rack and Undying picked up straight away. So these teams still want to play very seriously. But indeed, these are our winners of the group. So it's going to be good fun to see how these guys play and see if Ninjas in Pyjamas are able to give 4ASC a little bit more of a run for their money than they did in game one. But, Harney, these are the two strongest teams in the group.
Yes, it just looks like that. And you were mentioning that we might see some fun picks, but it looks like on the side of 4ASC, we just see that last shot again. And maybe NIP just wants to re-roll their draft and just show that they can win with what they just had. But hopefully we get some fun going here.
Yeah, I mean, we're going to see the Witch Doctor come out, which is always nice as their second pick. I'd be surprised if they don't get Yonis and Fan his axe again. And again, we're pretty much seeing an exact repeat apart from the Witch Doctor from the side of Four Anchors. So they pick up the Bloodseeker again for what we can imagine to be Matumba Man's hero. And the Bloodseeker did do a lot of work in that first game, I felt.
Very true. I think Matumba Man figured out the hero and how he has to run it. And with the start that he had, it just snowballed from there. He had a great impact in the game. It feels like a bit pubbish to me. This hero just, we had so much action where there was very little farming phase at all in this game, and it was just straight up smoke ganks into pushes and counter ganks, and it just felt very pubbish, that kind of game.
It was very, very hectic indeed here in both sides with the bans. We can see Ninjas in Pyjamas, they do ban out the Shadow Demon, which we saw being used very nicely in the first game by Boogie for the side of Four Anchors. So an understandable ban there from the side. And Four Anchors and Sea Captain, they ban out the Disruptor. They also ban out the TA this match. What's up with that, honey?
TA? I'm wondering. I guess if you run a Leshrac middle, and it looks like it's going to be that Leshrac middle again, if Matumba is going to play that Bloodseeker, that TA is one of the heroes, especially if you don't run Edict, you have nothing to really proc those charges. So okay, it's going to be a better hero against the Leshrac middle.
Oh, we're going to see Poke be picked up. And I've got to be honest, every time that I've seen Limp play that hero, he's been pretty damn good on it. It's got to be one of his heroes that he's got an impressive win rate on. And shout out to the stats people, of course, who've been doing the work here on the TI qualifiers. And I'm sure they'll be able to get me a tasty, tasty stat up on Limp Puck as we get ourselves into the game. Because I don't know, man, his Puck is pretty scary. And against a Leshrac in the mid lane, Puck should have a fairly good time, surely.
I think both heroes have an okay time.
Okay.
Just because you can most likely dodge that lightning, and it's really hard to hit any of the spells of Leshrac onto that Puck unless you miss shift.
Yes.
It's gonna be tough.
Yeah.
Maybe you can on the side of, if you're Leshrac, you can probably bait out spells. So maybe he uses shift preemptive, and then you get a chance to nuke him. But generally, it's kind of boring. I was on the side of 4ASC. Like when I was playing with Trixie in the game, and I know there's very little on the line, or you know you're out already.
Yes.
Hoping to see a Pudge.
A Pudge.
It's just
it could come out. You reckon?
It just is a zero. But we see a Nyx Assassin, and it looks like both teams are still taking this very serious.
Yeah, indeed. I mean, they want to go for the points. They want to go for the glory. Of course, if the side of Four Anchors and Sea Captain take this one, that means that in the group stage, 3 wins. And a draw, which is going to look very impressive. You know, obviously, it doesn't mean anything in terms of the standings, but it's going to be looking good for the team. And obviously, a lot of people will have a lot of respect for Four Anchors going into the playoff section of this tournament. The final ban for Ninjas in Pyjamas is going to be that AA. Obviously, a hero that works very nicely, obviously, with the Bloodseeker's global potential in terms of vision, and also with the Nyx Assassin in the way that you can look for the ganks with a Vendetta and with the stun be able to set up a very nice Ice Blast.
I think A is also one of those bans. You want to do it where when you're committed to a push, fighting into an A is very hard. And when you're NIP here, if you go with a Pugna, which pretty much means that you kind of want to finish out the game early on.
Yes, yeah.
And you sit on a Pugna ward, it's just very annoying facing an AA blast. So I understand that reasoning. With the AA, taking it out, you just don't face it, and your mech is gonna be still there.
Okay, now final ban from the side of four anchors. Indeed, with the Pugna, we can obviously expect it to be the era Pugna in that farming position. So they are still looking for that final hero for the side of Ninjas in Pyjamas, which I guess will be Yonas and Fam. I'm trying to. Do we ever see Yonas and Fam pick up the puck for a solo lane, or is it pretty much always limp in the mid lane? I'm pretty sure it's normally limp, isn't it?
Yeah,
it'll be limp puck.
I think it's going to be a limp puck here.
Do they pick up Axe for Yonas and Fam again?
I'm not sure. Can be something where as X can initiate, then you drop the Puna ward, and it's pretty good.
Yeah.
But it's hard to tell what their push strat is, you know, it's supposed to be looking like.
Yeah.
The one question you can ask right now, whether or not they're going to contest. They have a chance to contest it and do the same thing with a Puna where they want to pressure that Bloodseeker. But it can also just be the opposite, where you run a short lane, tri lane, and then you just take that first tower very early. You just want to continue push by push by push. But when you run a Bloodseeker, it's not the greatest heroes to run it as a tri lane, just because you won't have levels. Bloodseeker wants to have a fast Thirst maxed out. And when you contest it, obviously it just doesn't happen that fast.
Oh, it's going to be the Venomancer for the side of Ninjas in Pyjama. And I think that does indeed lead us to the fact that it'll almost certainly be Omni Knight. That's nice. You know, something a little bit different. So I'd imagine it's going to be the Yonasim fan Venomancer. And I guess with that pickup, probably going to be in the solo safe lane. And then do you think they'll run the Witch Doctor and Dying and Pugna aggressive against the Tri-Lane and Four Anchors?
I do think so, yes.
Okay, and well, ladies and gentlemen, welcome to what's going to be the second game and the final game of the day in tandem with Alliance versus PR going on the other stream here at the TI5 EU qualifiers. And Ninjas in Pyjamas versus the side of Four Anchors and Sea Captain. Looking at the draft, I mean, Harney, what are your early predictions here? Do you think Four Anchors have what it takes to take this series as a clean sweep with this lineup?
I think if Four Anchors manages to push the game a bit, getting a bit more in that later portion of the game, 30 plus minutes, then it should be their game. But if NIP impresses with an early pressure on their short lane, or they dominate the tri lane with their aggressive Pugna tri lane, then I think it's going to be very hard for 4SC to not get pushed over.
Okay, and here we go. Let's see what it comes. And there we go. There's the stat that we wanted to see. So Limp indeed, 22 wins to 13 losses all time on the puck. And okay, Yonas has played it before. Okay, but he's 2 wins and 7 losses. So it looks like they probably want to keep him away from the puck and let it go to Limp, as he's obviously had a bit of a superior time. I guess sometimes, you know, they pick it up maybe for the mid lane for Limp, and it's a situation in which they don't want to run the puck in the mid lane and they want to force it to the side lane instead and pick up something that's going to fare better off in that mid lane situation. But ladies and gentlemen, here with game two between Ninjas in Pyjamas and Four Anchors Sea Captain, here with myself, Odie Pixel, and Harney. On the side of NIP, it's going to be Hansken on his Undying Seal. Get on the Witch Doctor this time. Era on that position one puck. Now, it will be Limp on his signature puck. Yonas and Fan on what looks to be that solo safe lane Venomancer. And Harney, what are we seeing from the side of 4SC?
On the side of 4SC, we have Trixie this time. Instead of Beastmaster, now sitting on that Nyx Assassin. And again, we have a mid lane Nymphy Leshrac. And on the supports, we have Valix sitting on the line, as well as Boogie on an Omni Knight, with the Kerry Matumba on Bloodseeker.
Okay, indeed. So some similar stuff with a little bit of a twist coming out from both sides into this second game. And it looks like, indeed, they are going to rotate this tri lane down to the bottom lane on the side of NIP. So, well, lane-wise, this game, who are we expecting to come out on top here, do you feel, in the early game?
It's really tough to tell, depending on how good that bottom lane goes.
Okay.
If NIP manages to get a hat on that bottom lane, they will be there for sure. They will have a pretty good time going into the mid game. But if they fall behind, I almost think that this game is going to be catastrophic for them.
We'll see what the side of NIP are able to achieve indeed here on this aggressive tri lane. The top lane, so this Nyx Assassin versus a Venomancer. See, Nick's fairly tanky with that base HP regen. Do you think he's going to be fine up here against the old poisonous one?
I mean, Nyx Assassin has that base regen that is very high. He does not have a mango right now. He just finished that Portman shield. It looks alright. He could potentially pick up a mango, so his base regen goes up to almost 4, I think. Yeah, he's sitting at 3.1 right now, so he's going to be going to 4.1, and that's a lot of regen. But usually you would say that Venomancer, especially if he gets higher level into that poison sting, Nyx Assassin should have that harder time.
Okay, indeed. And then finally, of course, this Puck versus Leshrac mid lane. At the moment, Limp having the superior time here, 5-4 at the moment against the 2-1 on Nemphy. It still is early days, but this is looking to be a very strong start for Limp, especially seeing as he's got this wave as well to clear up here that's going to put him very much ahead of the Leshrac.
Yeah, it's looking good for Limp. I would say that Puck should have a slighter edge in the very start, but it's really hard to, you know, like to push out a Leshrac from that lane. He will just essentially farm. He's gonna have an okay time. If he focuses on just farming, it's gonna be fine. But if he tries to arrest that Puck, it can really spiral against him as well.
Ooh, bottom lane here, we do see the Dracorepa fire and the blast being thrown down onto the Timberman, bringing him low. But still 2 minutes in yet. We're not seeing as much aggression as we saw in the first game. CS-wise on the top lane, Trixie's managed to find himself 8 against Jonas and Fans 12, but we are indeed getting to that point now with 2 points in the Poison Sting and a point in Gale. Trixie's going to have to be a little bit careful about getting close and personal with this Venomancer. But still, yeah, 0-0 at this point. I mean, does this aggressive trial, do they need to be finding kills here? I mean, Witch Doctor and Undying, can they look for any kind of rotations in this early portion of the game?
I think so far it's just important that he makes sure Puck has a good time. And initiation bottom.
Indeed, Blood right and the stun's being put down to Seal Kid. First Blood has already been given, in fact, the top lane as Venomancer was able to find a solo kill of the Nyx Assassin. On this bottom lane as well, things looking very nice for NIP as they're going to find two here as both the Omni Knight and the Bloodseeker go down. Apologies for missing that kill up top. Looks like Unison Fan must have indeed gone in with a level 2 Gale and a level 2 Poison Sting and just right-clicked Trixie down. At the same time, NIP, yeah, with these two kills down bottom, this is the kind of start that Ninjas in Pyjamas will be looking for with a lineup like this to get the ball rolling.
And I would like to point out that Decrify play onto the totem was just beautiful. If that did not happen, totem is going to be down and you potentially just get out with dying once or even maybe winning that fight. But the Decry on the totem just meant that Matumaman had 3 zombies on him and he just got slowed down and died as well.
I mean, in the first fight, we did see 4SC being very good about focusing down that tombstone. Every fight that they went into, they went straight for it. And yeah, and this kind of combination and synergy that we don't really see that much, the fact that that Decrepify can allow your tombstone to have a good few seconds extra of lifetime is going to be pretty big for these engagements when they kick off between the sides of NIP and 4SC.
Very true. And so far, it's looking very good for NIP here. They wanted to run more of an early style of game, with having a Pugno on their lineup as carry, and so far they're succeeding on pretty much all lanes.
Indeed, with that kill and assist here for Era. And as well in terms of farm on the bottom lane, you know, 22-3 on Era compared to the 14-2 on Matumbaman. Matumbaman having a pretty atrocious time here against this Pugno. With the rappel coming out here for him to help him against the blast and burst damage. But still, he's finding it very hard to find any kind of farm against this tri-lane.
And we can see Valix is slowly rotating towards the top lane as the Lion. It's just an Omni Knight as well as the Bloodseeker sitting on that bottom lane, but I do assume that he's going to try to set up a gank here.
He's going to look to try and find something indeed, but the question is, can he? Jonasson Fan, sitting on 700 HP at the moment, got a couple of bullet charges. Jonasson Fan's just going to walk straight into him. He knows that the Lion is there now, so it's going to be very hard for Valix to find anything. And this, of course, is going to give the information to the rest of the side of NIP that there is only the Omni Knight down here protecting this Bloodseeker. Indeed, top lane, Lion getting low, and Jonasson Fan just kills him. This was not the rotation that the side of 4SC were looking for, throwing away the Lion there to the solo lane Venomancer. Now they're going to try and find a little bit of reverse aggression here onto Era, trying to chase him down with a rappel onto Matumbaman, allowing him to go a little bit at hand, but Seal Kid with the point of Vita Restoration, it's enough. There's going to be the Decrepify and Blast coming out to Matumbaman. He's desperately trying to find the kill onto Seal Kid. There's going to be a Sorit from Hanskane keeping the Witch Doctor alive. Will he go down? He will indeed. Matumbaman does finally find the kill, and Matumbaman trying to look for more here. Will back off now as Hanskane's ready to go back in with a Decay, and he's going to find it, bringing the Bloodseeker incredibly low, who backs himself out behind that tower. So obviously 4SC finding something from that fight, but still 4-1, a very strong start here for NIP.
Recapping a top situation, what happened is that the Jonasson Fan scouted him out. He was looking for him because he was expecting line rotating. Mm-hmm. He did only see two heroes bottom lane.
Oh, yeah. He found a solo kill there onto the old Bloodseeker, and even with the help of Buki, couldn't obviously get out the purification or repel.
I can only imagine that Matumba was trying to get those last hits to heal up again. And he was just greedy. He was very low, and Era saw the opportunity. He saw that he was going to heal up, and he just abused that fact.
This is very, very strong play here from the side of NIP. And, I mean, there we go. So, in Pro-Dota history, it's only actually been run 20 times and twice in the EU qualifiers so far. So certainly working out for NIP this game. Handscamp will drop the Tombstone. Bloodright comes out from Matumba Man. But NIP, they just don't care. The side of 4SC have to back themselves out in a way, and they'll have to sack this tower here on the bottom lane. Fortification will come out, but they won't be able to stop this one going down as Seal Kid, Era, and Handscamp will bring the Tier 1 down here. And things looking very nice for NIP in this stage of the game. And still in the mid lane as well, the fact that Limp on 30 CS, 9 denies at the moment, looking very, very good for the team. I mean, Nemphy did catch up and sitting on 34 for 3 at the moment. But he has not been able to find the same amount of action as he did in the first game. I think we're, 9 minutes in, he had something ridiculous like 7 kills. This game, he's not been involved in anything. And I don't know, man. This, I don't know, 4SC, it's not going as well as game 1.
It's looking very tough for them right now, but they're for sure not Norni out. Like I was mentioning, if NIP can get a good start, they're staying in this game. Mm-hmm. It's for them, it's about staying in this game and progressing on their pressure. We most likely will look towards a mech here on Era and then going into potential Ag, something like that. Maybe even a book, but it is very important for them getting that good start for their strat.
Matumba Man just trying to soak up XP here on the bottom lane. Still, he's got to be so, so careful about coming in close. Because if he gets caught out by the decrepit fire, he's going to be a whole world of pain with Silken and Hanscan hanging in on the sidelines.
Top lane.
They want to push, and indeed, they're trying to dive in onto Jonas and Fan here with a haste win onto Nemphy. They'll almost certainly find this kill. Jonas and Fan will try to run. He'll try to hide, looks for a cheeky deny. Isn't going to be able to get it off. He will fall bottom lane, though. At the side of NIP with the rotation from Limp, Dreamcall onto Matumba Man, and with the Sucky Sucky from Era bringing him low. Matumba Man trying to get to the high ground. The right clicks will chase him down, and Limp does find the kill there. They might even be able to find Nemphy as well here with the boosted magical damage thanks to the Decrepify bringing him low. There'll be a hex onto Limp. Varlik's incredibly low as well as Nemphy. They've got to back themselves up. The light still comes through. They will be able to pick off Limp in return, making that global trade there a 2-for-1. NIP will try and look to finish off this tier 2 here on the bottom lane, though, and well, okay, maybe not. They want to back themselves out to base. They do not want to stick around because Strixie coming in. The stone was just a little bit short anyway, but still, NIP, the aggression paying off for the most part of it, but not great for them losing the puck there on that bottom lane.
It was very close for them getting those two kills, so you can't really blame them on going for that kill or the two kills even. But if they wouldn't have done it, they would have had that second tower on the bottom lane. So in a way, it still hurts.
Indeed, it does. 9 minutes in. Let's have a look, in fact, at the hero's kind of net worth thanks to this early game momentum. So it is 4.3k at the moment still for Nemphy on this Leshrac. He is at the top, but very close behind his Era with the 4.2. And then straight away, Jonasson, Fan, and Limp all joining the gang. All nice and high up that board indeed. And the overall difference is our net worth is around 3k. XP, we're pretty much still bang on zero in this earlier portion of the game. But NIP looking to continue that net worth lead here, looking for some more money as they'll try and take down this tier 1 on the top lane. And I just feel at this point, I mean, can 4SC do anything to defend against this, or do they just want to be looking to find the farm elsewhere on the map?
If you can't find a Leshrac being on that top lane, you're just going to lose those towers. I think Leshrac has noticed that Pugna is going to, he's going to get his levels on Nether Ward, and it's just very tough. Once the Nether Ward drops, you just take so much damage yourself that you just want to trade. And we can see that Nemphy just took that middle tower and he managed to get a successful trade.
He did indeed. Now with the wraparound, Trixie with the Vendetta, the double damage. Maybe they can find something in return. There's a sentry ward down that they know that the Nyx Assassin is here. They'll try and catch him out, but he's ready to burst them down. Era will blow up, hits the Lightning Storm as well, and Nemphy going in with the Repel. The stun here onto Handscan. They should be able to find him as well. It's a double kill here for the Leshrac. It might even be a triple kill as they're looking for Jonasson Fan here with the Lightning Storm. He's still got that split off available now. Is he going to be able to find it? He might not even need to. The AoE damage is enough. It's a triple kill for Nemphy here on the Leshrac. It is going to end up being a 3-for-3 trade, though, as the side of NIP were able to find both the Lion, the Nyx Assassin, and the Omni Knight.
And I was mentioning how much the Nether Ward hurts, but obviously there's a Repel.
Yes.
If you get the Repel on the Leshrac, then he just essentially doesn't care. He will not. And the way the fight started, it was really good for the side of 4SC. They took out that Pugna from the very start. Great stun by Trixie here. He gets that impale onto the Pugna follow-up stun, as well as the lightning off the Lashrak, and he just exploded.
Indeed, it's 6-9 at the moment. 11 minutes 20 in. Varlix just ran out the stun. They're trying to clear out this wave. The blast coming through, just tickling away at this tower, bringing it down. And Dera, of course, just 100 got away from the mech. Voracy, they might look to try and catch this one out. They're actually going to back away from this. Looks like they don't want to go directly in. They're going to wait for backup. Now they've got backup.
I was going to mention that Trixie's going to almost have a very quick blink dagger on that next assassin, but he chooses to go for that Midas. I tweeted at him earlier for not getting Midas on heroes.
Oh, look at this. Nemphy just going straight in here with the repel. There'll be a hex onto Limp. Tombstone has been dropped here by the side of NIP. They want to try and fight into this one. Seal Kid with the Voodoo Restoration, keeping the team topped up. There'll be a Bloodrite coming through. It's going to connect onto Limp, Era, and Jonas and Fandreamcall, trapping the Timberman. He's just going to run this one off. The blast hitting onto the tower. Timberman trying to get himself away. The only casualty being that Leshrac here from the side of 4SC. NIP standing pretty strong. The Radiant, meanwhile, they did manage to find this bottom tower here with the creep waves coming through. But it looks like they will lose the tier 2 here on the top, the side of 4SC, as NIP are able to take that one. And now with a rotation potentially towards the mid lane, ready to look for some more towers from the side. I mean, NIP's lineup, it certainly seems to be working in terms of push potential.
It does. And I still want to go back to that Midas pick up here by Trixie.
Yeah, I mean, why the Midas, Arnie?
Obviously, he just wants to stay in the game, getting form. But to me, the way the NIP just works is if you can't finish that game in the mid game, you're not gonna win. You're not gonna win against the Leshrac Bloodseeker with that kind of strat. And you want to have the initiation on the Nyx Assassin, and he's not gonna find anything if he does not have a Blink Dagger. It's gonna be very, very hard going into that 5-on-5.
Indeed, and NIP, they're ready to try and push here for SC. They're ready with the defenses standing behind the tier 1. Let's see if they're able to do anything about NIP knocking on their door. Era just coming in time and time again with the Nether Blast, dropping the tower low, and this is very hard to do anything against. This Hearthspike will come out, doesn't connect onto anyone. Trixie walking forward will be caught out by the Dream Call. There's going to be a repel onto Leshrac, allowing him to get the damage out. Trixie with the Vendetta trying to get himself out, but he gets burst down by Limp. The Bloodrite does catch them all, but NIP, they just don't really care. The Voodoo Restoration was already on. And off the back of that, they'll take down the tier 1 here from the side of 4SC, and it just looks like the side of 4SC having so much trouble trying to stop this momentum from NIP.
Right now, we just don't have the levels on the Omni Knight. We can see that he even undervalues his purification. He doesn't max out the heal because he knows he has to have the repel. And it's going to be very crucial if we see a Diffusion Blade on anyone on the side of NIP. And if we look at the Venomancer, he is about to have his Diffusion. This game is going to turn very bad. He actually doesn't go Diffusion. He actually aims towards the Yasha. Never mind that.
Okay, indeed, this kind of right-click, speedy little Venomancer build. And Era, I mean, yep, comes in for a blast, walks back out, rinse and repeat for SC. I think that'd be kind of an infuriating thing to play against, as Era just whittles away at her out of defenses. I mean, what do you do to stop this? Do you just have to run straight in and force a fight, or do you just have to accept the fact that your tier 2 is going down whether you like it or not?
It doesn't look like it's going to happen.
Yeah, I mean, I guess he's going to have level 11 soon. I know the Midas has helped with that.
He's getting the levels, that's very true, but he's just not getting that essential item to stop a push. You want him to jump in. You really do.
Split off onto the Jonathan fan there. Never was being dropped. Nemphy's got the repel seal kit. He's getting caught out here. There's going to be the Tombstone drop down the side of NIP. They've lost the Witch Doctor. Witch Doctor will buy back straight into this one. The Dream Call onto Boogie and Trixie. And now with the huge Venomancer catching them all, two heroes have fallen so far. Trixie continues to tick down. Matumaman questioning whether he can get himself back and involved into this fight. But NIP, they just stand there and continue to press down to the tier 2. The creep wave comes in now, so the backdoor defense will be gone. And now Blink 4 from Link, catching out Varlix here with the waning rift of the orb. And now the final right click, bringing down the Lion. Nemphy's TP'd into this one, but he could be in a bit of trouble. He's bringing Seal Kid low, though. Does get himself a double kill with that one. The split off misses onto Limp. Handscan still pretty high and getting a fair few decays here as he turns around at this one. Limp might want to go back in, and he certainly does with the waning rift and the orb. They take down the next assassin. He's looking for Nemphy as well. Can he find this one? No, he needs to go and help Jonathan Fan, who's having to deal with this Bloodseeker. Gale flies for you. The right clicks are there. They take down the Bloodseeker 16-9 for the side of NIP still. And a pretty hectic game. In terms of XP, it's around the zero mark. But in terms of gold-wise, NIP continuing to break away, and they'll be able to break away even more here if they're able to finish off this tier two. I mean, what can 4SC do to stop this, Harney?
I was going to say, it looks pretty okay for the start of that last fight. I was thinking, okay, they might have a pretty good chance at coming back into this game, but it just turned out very bad for them. They did not get those picks, and Nyxus has died again. He's nowhere near getting that initiation that they essentially need in this game. And you have a Bloodseeker that sits at level 9 right now. Bloodseeker is just one of those heroes you want to get at least drop to level 2. It's so important for the hero that you get enough damage into the ultimate. And it also means that Bloodseeker in these fights, you can see he uses Rupture, but he can't walk in. He can't walk into this AoE. You give the repel to the Lashrak, and he walks in. And I'm still waiting to see a Diffusion Blade on the side of NIP to just perch him. There's not going to be a Lincolns fast enough to write that Diffusion Blade over. And if they get a Diffusion Blade, there's no chance for 4SC on this to get any fight going at all.
Indeed, I mean, there's going to be a Rupture here from the high ground onto Aero. Trixie coming in with the Vendetta, but they've got a Sentry down the side of NIP. They're prepared here for this Nyx Assassin as Silky getting himself a little bit low. Has got the Viewer Restoration, keeping him topped up. Hanskin's really trying to find this one. Silky, he goes down, and he will fall. They've lost both Silkid and Limp on the side of NIP. They lose Aero as well. This is a very good fight for the side of 4SC. There'll be a buyback from Pugna. Yuren Sifan getting that off onto Matumba Man, and Matumba Man will simply TP himself back to base here. NIP holding them for here as they did lose a few with the buyback coming out as we see Mera now return to the Roshan fight. 4SC, can they jump back into this one? Doesn't look like they want to. They're backed right out of this one. And I don't know, can NIP finish off Rosh here?
It looks like they can continue because NIP, I would say 4SC needed to heal up, but we can see Leshrac sitting at 11 Bloodstone charges. So he has a lot of mana to play around with. And I think it's crucial that NIP just doesn't get that Diffusion Blade. I feel like if you would have a Diffusion right now, that you purge off the Repel and then the sugar is food.
Oh, there's going to be a Cast Scout. There's going to be a Bloodseeker Rupture onto Unison Fan from the high ground. They're trying to suck his mana down as well. Unison Fan's going to be fine for the time being. As no, Matumba Man with the wraparound. Looks like they're about to bring down with Nemphy in the right clicks. They will bring down the Venomancer. But looks like NIP, they want to try and find something in return here. Decrepify onto Matumba Man. He's going to have to run. Will the bounces be there? No, he's going to bounce the way off the creep wave. They do finish off the Leshrac. Will they find this Bloodseeker as well? He's all trapped up here in the tree line. The Waning Rift comes through. He will go down. Limp's able to dodge the blood right there with a phase shift. And they do find themselves two kills in return. So a bit of a messy fight going on between the sides here. Roshan is indeed still up, just sitting over half health. And the question is whether NIP want to try and go back in for this one now after these fights.
And it looks like they're just going to go back into the Rosh fight. We have a Leshrac that just respawned already, just because he had 11 charges. He's now sitting back at 8. It's still pretty good for him. They have Dominator on his side, so he has that Repel level 4 available to go into the fight.
Here we go, we're seeing a bit of the same again. Repel onto Nemphy. Wants to try and see if he can find an initiation with the Lightning Storm. And there we go. Gets the stone to Sealkid and Hanskin, but Limp Lick it void it. A Dream Coil onto Free. Very nicely done. They brought down the Omni Knight. Era getting caught out. The Sorrow's going to buy him some time, keeping him alive, keeping him up with the mech as well. Era's going to live. Now they can just try and turn this one around onto Nemphy. Limp, he's already picking off the supports on the back line. They've lost the line on the side of 4SC. They will lose the Leshrac as well. It's a killing spree here for Hanskin. And Limp, he's not done. He wants to find more, but the Vendetta, the stun, is going to be dodged by the face shift. Does he get himself out of this one? No, he doesn't. There is going to be the nuke damage to bring him down. Flies through, connects onto Trixie. Yonison Fan, he's now being ruptured. Matumba Man, can he find the kill on this one? There is backup from the side of NIP. You do not want to be running into this one, Bloodseeker. He'll just pop down the blood right. He's still questioning whether he wants to go in onto this. Yonison Fan just simply sitting there. But now that Silk is coming, yeah, you don't want to chase this one down. Now, NIP, do they go for Roshan? Now, this has got to be one of the most elongated and drawn out Rosh fights we've seen. And no, they're going to leave it for the time being. But it will almost still certainly be a point of contest as.
How long was that Rosh fight? There was at least like 3-4 minutes that they just stood there trying to get Rosh fighting instead. I mean, you can't blame 4SC for still sticking around Rosh. They obviously don't want to give it away.
No.
But it's just impressive how much endurance both teams have for that Rosh.
It is indeed at this point. 21 minutes in, NIP still looking to be in the slightly superior position. But there still is definitely the point for 4SC to pull some big moves out of the back. The fact that Nemphy looking... Well, I guess he's seen better days now. His Bloodstone charges have dropped fairly heftily. I mean, it was what, up to about 11?
We just see that smoke coming out. And they're rotating around. They drew where they want to go. And it looks... If they can get that pickup, it should result into most likely a Roshan kill. Can they make that happen?
Limp's got this dream call. This could be a very big dream call. It's going to be just the waning rift onto Matumba Man now. Varlix and Boogie coming in. They need to be careful. Tombstone's been dropped on the high ground here with the Paralyzing cards coming out onto Matumba Man. He's going to be healed by the Purification now. Comes out the ultimate from the Omni Knight. He pops the Rupture onto Era. And now Matumba Man, he's going to try and TP out, but it's not going to get him out. This one, they lose Boogie as well here on the side of 4SC. They might lose Nemphy as well as the zombies chasing him down, slowing him down. Seal can look and see if he can find an initiation. Limp's going to have the Blink Dagger in a few seconds as well. Nemphy trying to turn around and get the damage out. The ult will come out and then deconnect onto Nemphy, and there's your Yule Sept onto the Nyx Assassin. On the bow steal with the Death Ward bouncing through as well. Trixie getting low. There'll be a Bloodstone Suicide from Nemphy here on the Leshrac. Trixie just TPing back to base from the high ground. They've already lost three heroes here the side of 4SC, and they find nothing from the side of NIP. And I think this could be the opening that NIP will look for to try and finally take down Roshan Harney.
It might be the case, but if we look at the time of Leshrac, he's sitting at 10 seconds only. He still has enough charges to come back. Okay, now he's sitting at 3, but he will come back in time before the Roshan goes down. Looks like 4C is attempting that defense. They're going to smoke up right now.
Okay, let's see if they can go in for the second round here onto Roshan. There's been so much action gravitating around this area of the map for the last, 5 or 6 minutes, it almost feels like.
And I was mentioning the Diffusion Blade on towards the Venomancer. And he's going for it right now.
Okay.
He has an extra Blade of Alacrity, and he most likely will get that.
Okay, here we go. 4SC, they're ready to try and fight again. This time when they come out on top, they're jumping straight on Terror. Can they burst him down before he can do anything? They do. They take down the Pugna. Varlix getting low hit to Silky. There's going to be a Dream Call onto Free Nemphy. Still with a Repel, trying to fight for this one. It's going to be a 1-for-1 so far as Matumba Man. He drops on the Bloodseeker. Silky, he's going to get fingered, but he's going to be able to ward this one out. And Limp blinking forward here, looking for the right clicks onto Varlix. Can't quite find it. The Purification is going to be there from Boogie, allowing Varlix to live through this one. Limp might find the kill onto Trixie. No, he's going to be fine, I think, for the time being. No, the Waiting Rift. He's going to be okay with the Impale, turning it around as a limb, holding him in place, and now with a Repel onto Trixie. Trixie's just turning this one around and looks to TP straight out of this one. That's probably not the best move there, as he will go down. Limp blinking forward. He wants to try and find Boogie. It's a 3-for-1 so far with the Orb flying forward. They'll get enemy out to chase this down with the Waning Rift. The right clicks of Limp with this double damage, doing a lot of work. Killing spree for the Puck. It ends up a 4-for-1, and again, 4SC, they try to contest Roshan, but NIP just coming out on top in these fights.
And I do think they will get that Roche now.
Yeah. This has got to be the window to finish it.
The Shrag is out now, but I really don't think they're going to make it there in time. But it looks like if we can see the aggressive TP coming up by the Shrag. He's moving towards Roshan, but I just can't see him coming there in time.
Yeah, here we go. We'll finally drop the Roshan going the way of NIP. They were to get themselves that Aegis as well. It looks like they're going to be giving it to Era as he moves into position.
And that was essentially a 10-minute window of
pretty much
fighting around Roshan.
It looks like it's going to continue even with Roshan down. They're going to find the Gale and the Waning Rift onto Nemphy. Can they pick this one off? Very nice Dream Call catching Matumba Man in the tree line and Nemphy right in the center. And with the ult flying from Jonas and Fan connects onto Matumba Man. Matumba Man turns around with a Rupture onto Jonas and Fan, but it doesn't really matter. He's already used the ult and the Gale there. He's not really needed for this fight. Hanskin and Era, they can look to try and clean this one up. There'll be a Purification coming through. It's not enough to keep the line alive. He will fall down. Matumba Man is being repelled, trying to find this one. Phase shift from Limp, just going to hold him safe and sound. Matumba Man has to head right back up to the base. Again, 32-16 between these sides. NIP massively pulling ahead at this point. I mean, the minus on your Nyx Assassin, it's allowed him to get his Aghanims, but the question is the Aghanims going to be enough to do anything of any kind of, you know, kind of momentum at this point, Harney?
I mean, now he can hold high ground to some extent, but I just believe that getting that initiation from the very start, where he was 1500 gold, he got the recipe, but he could have waited out 500 more gold and just get that Blink Dagger. I felt like it would have been just a better tool to stop the defense, to also initiate, where right now, pretty much still at that point, you have 25 minutes in only a Leshrac that can walk in with a Repel.
Yeah.
And against that, we're going to see the Fusion Blade very soon on the Venomancer.
Indeed, he's got those double Blade of Alacrities out. And also worth noting as well that Era on the Pugna did just finish up his Aghanims as well on top of that Mech and Arcane Boots. So Things looking very healthy for the side of NIP. After that Rosh fight, what kind of gold difference we're seeing? It's only around the 8K mark, so 26 minutes in. It's not the biggest of leads. So for ASC, they still definitely do have the potential to pull this one back. But it's kind of up to what Nemphy can do on this Leshrac. And he's not been having the best of fights recently. Down to a very poor old looking one Bloodstone charge. He's working towards that BKB and he has now got it. The recipe just being flown out to him on the courier. So maybe if they look to force a fight here on the top lane, 4SC can try and come out on top. But just looking at the tools that NIP have at their disposal, it's going to be so hard to go against this size on 5v5.
And it looks like they're already heading back because they just know that they're not going to be pushing as fast. They still have a top tower sitting there as well. It's too much to handle.
Ooh, they're managing to control Era very nicely, and Aegis will be popped straight away. Nemphy walking in with a BKP, trying to see what can find him. Dude, there's going to be a rupture onto Lim, making it hard for him to get around the fight. Can they bring down Era a second time? The mech's going to be there. Right click, flying through the Decrepify. He's going to be fine for the time being. You understand, Fan getting a very nice onto Trixie and Nemphy, and now with the Death Ward, but there's the Omni Knight ult there indeed, and that's going to be that physical damage. It's going to do absolutely nothing. The side of Forestry, they're okay for the time being. Trixie owning himself still, but the zombies, they're building up. They'll take down the Nyx Assassin. It ends up being a one for one trade so far. And the NIP, they're just going to try and get some damage onto this tier 3 now. Now can 4SC do anything? They haven't got a Nyx Assassin for a good 45 seconds. Era will be back in just 20 here.
And I was going to say that Burrow ability onto the Nyx Assassin with the Ganims. He was sitting very far back in start of the fight. He has a 900 range mana burn as well as 1050 range Impale. And he was sitting so far back, I believe that Era was just surprised by that mana burn stun combo. And he blew up. But he came back and they were just, he was very close to dying again. Trixie thought that they didn't have that sentry out, but they put out that sentry and killed him in the Boro. It just looked very funny because he was sitting down there just throwing out Impale and Mana Burn and just thinking that he would not be caught.
Oh, hang on. Lim, he's picked off the Omni Knight, and the Omni Knight's been pretty key for the fights for 4ASC. Nemphy caught out in the middle of it all, and it's going to be a double kill for Era as NIP just catching 4SC out. And now with three heroes down, this isn't looking great for the health of the base of 4SC. Defusal now completed onto your Venomancer, but indeed, as you're saying, that initiation and buzz, I guess a lol from Nemphy. Just the fact that Aghanim's Nyx Assassinate could be a little bit annoying to play against.
Because he has the Blood Rage off the Bloodseeker.
Tricks here. This turret indeed. Trunkar will be dropped onto Matumba Man. He's got a blade mail. Is it going to be enough to keep him alive? No, the all flies through. They take down the Bloodseeker. Limp down an unstoppable kill streak. There'll be a buyback from this Bloodseeker. They're trying to defend the base. They have lost the tier 3 here in the mid lane. Jonas and Fan setting up a fort here with these wards. There's going to be Bloodrite being popped down. Trixie going back into turret mode here with the stuns and with the heals, with the everything being thrown down. There's going to be Jonas and Fan going low here. Nemphy coming in with the magical damage. Era trying to keep him alive with the heal. Look at this teamwork. It won't quite be enough as Venomancer does fall here on the side of NIP. And now NIP, they've got to think about backing themselves out of this one, heading back down the lane. Silky will look for a TP out in the sidelines. They will be able to get himself away. Trixie wasn't able to find the stun. Everything flying through at the end, but it's a little bit too late to catch anyone else out. Just finding the Venomancer there on that defense, but I mean, yeah, indeed, the Nyx Assassin Blood Rage combo with that Aghanim's, it's pretty scary, especially when you're trying to push up to high ground against it.
It's just that Blood Rage, the amount of damage you deal with that Mana Burn is insane. You get some Mana Burn off, if you think of having something like a Dagon on top of that, he would instant blow up someone. I'm actually wondering what kind of item build he's going to go for now. I still think a dagger would be optimal, but okay. Who knows? He might go for that Dagon 5 and just mana burn snipe someone.
Dagon 5 would be fun, yeah, indeed. If you pop the Blood Rage on him and he just goes with your 1-2 burst combo, it's going to be pretty scary for some of these heroes on the side of NIP.
I guess one thing we also have to mention is that now we see a BKB on the Leshrac.
Yes.
It just, the defusal is not worthy anymore. It's just not as good. If you had it before, where he just had that Bloodstone, Leshrac could have blown up every single fight. But it's not bad, for sure. There's going to be a time where BKB is going to be down, but...
Yes, and Repel will be there. Yeah.
It just doesn't have that great of an impact anymore.
That is true. Let's see what NIP can do here. They're ready to try and go for a second round here on the mid lane. Trixie there. The turret is set up. And out comes the stun. There'll be Bloodbright as well. Trixie just going to back himself away from the side of NIP. And he's going to go back into turret mode here. Sentry has been dropped. And there. They will be able to take this ward away from the side of 4ASC. Mana Burn's just being thrown out left, right, and center here. Just being able to clear out the creep wave very nicely as well here. And NIP, can they push into this one? Lightning Storm coming out now. The BKB popped by Nemphy. Decides this is the time to go. Wants to try and fight into this one. Limp going forward there as well. A bit of a cheeky play. This is going to be able to phase shift dodge all the action out. Dreamcon has now been dropped. Only connects onto Nemphy here. The Omni Knight using his ultimate there to buy them some space and time. But now Nemphy gets burst down as he pops the Dreamcon on the center of the edge of it. And still Trixie trying to do what he can with the stun up here. Rupture thrown down onto Jonas and Fan. Yule Scepter onto Trixie. Limp on the sidelines here. He's still got that dagger on here. Repel onto Trixie trying to save him from the Nether Ward. That is zapping back at him, but they've lost half the racks here in the mid lane. It looks like they may lose the melee racks as well as they are getting incredibly low. Trixie looking for the stun onto Yenison Fan. Yenison Fan maybe wants to try and look to go for this one. Pop the Defusal Blade. The Gale will connect. No, they're just trying to create the space to finish off these racks in the mid lane NIP. So 38 for 18. I mean, we're certainly seeing a lot stronger performance from NIP in this game than we did in game one.
Yeah, it seems like their it just works out in this kind of game. I guess we can look at if we look at the BKB usage of the Leshra, we still have to say it's incredibly important that he doesn't waste that BKB. Once the BKB is down, you have a defusal. And if you then perch off the repel, they just lose that fight. And that's exactly what happened here. Nemphy went in with the BKB, he couldn't get anything done with it, he was slowed down still by the Venom Wards, and he moved back, then he got perched on the way back after still getting that repel. And it's just a tough thing to do, to take these fights when you're on the side of 4SC.
Deep 4SC, they are smoking up here, let's see if they can try and find some positive action. Limp, he's got an invis rune though. What a time to have an Invis Rune indeed. It's going to dispel the smoky onto Varlix, and they're going to see Matumba Man as well. Limp actually jumping forward here. Oh, will be able to find the Lion. Era's turned up to the fight as well. The question is, can 4SC find anything? Return Limp's out of mana, and they do. They're able to find the kill onto the put. Toonstone's been dropped by NIP. BKB by Nemphy. He's trying to run out. Matumba Man will simply TP away. Trixie tries to TP out, but realizes he's still in range of the Sucky Sucky action from Era. Now Era just looks for Nemphy as well. He'll be able to take down the Leshrac. It's a 3-for-1 trade there favoring the side of NIP. And well, that was not the kind of smoke gank that 4SC were looking for there.
And the action is just not stopping. We're sitting at 41 kills to 19 kills in a game of 33 minutes. It's just non-stop action in pretty much both of these series now.
Indeed it is. This is indeed this is very impressive stuff from the side of NIP. And Pugna, he's pretty much got a BKB finish now as well, Era. Looking very healthy. There's going to be big items coming out with the Vlads on top of the Vanguard and the Glimmer Cape pretty much done for Hansken. And yeah, 4SC not having as strong as the time as they did in the first game against this side. Venomancer now with that ultimate as well. We'll just see what he goes for. I guess on top of the SMY, what does Jonas and Fan go for on this right-clicking Venomancer? Do you reckon we could see something like a Skadi come out?
It could be something like Scotty. Maybe he wants to do that on top of it to just like get some more HP. It could be also just, you know, just getting Hex. Hex would be
yes,
too bad.
Yeah.
You just get another disable if you want to go high ground. You want to lock down the potential Omni Knight that repels or gets the Guardian Angel off. At this point, he has to get a Diffusal. It's not as great. Or I was thinking for a moment of a Manta as well, just because it has some sort of interaction with the Diffusal Blade. Where you have illusions,
that's
also mana
true.
Burning, but
yes.
He has a Sentient Yasha. He could spit that item though. He has a chance to spit the Sentient Yasha into both pieces and then just getting that Manta still.
I guess the possibility is certainly there as well for you. Of course, Jonas and Fan here on this Venomancer. Now, ready to try and push on to a second lane here, see if they can take a second set of racks away from the side of 4ASC.
And I was mentioning that they can pick up on the Nyx Assassin, and he's going for it.
Is he going
for
it? Okay. Let's see if Trixie's able to get that online in time. He's still what? He's coming up to the amount of money for that recipe. And then we'll see some heavy burst action coming out. But talking about burst action, of course, NIP with Limp already leveling up his Dagon. He's looking pretty damn scary. Tombstone's been dropped here onto the high ground. Matumba Man actually popping the BKB here to deal with this one. Repel gets thrown down onto Trixie. Limp at the moment. Where's he at? Well, he's looking for the wraparound here. Wants to try and find a dream card potential here. And there we go. On to three. Matumba Man, Yarlix, Volix, and Trixie all caught into it. Guardian's Angel coming out from the Omni Knight, and Trixie trying to stun this one up. Perhaps managing to mana burn the entirety of the mana pool from Sealkit with the Soul Rope. Now the Dagon from Limb picks off Varlix here on the Lion. And at the same time, just look at this pressure being applied by NIP onto this Tier 3. Trixie burrows up. He's going to see what he can do here in terms of stuns and holding back the creep wave. Bloodright will come down off the ground. Aero's able to duke it out on the sidelines. But Tumberman moving in here with the Blade Mail. And now Nemphy trying to come in as well, looking for the split off. We'll find it. Limp just blinking forward, getting the Waning Rift onto free. Oh, there's your Dagon onto Trixie. Burst down the Nyx Assassin. Limp being able to duke out the Lightning Storm. Nemphy looking to come in with the split off. It's not going to connect onto anyone. Now the Gale flies through. They ult from the Venomancer as well. Nemphy will simply BKB, trying to fight through this one. Aero with the BKB as well. He's looking to just continue to go into this one, draining the life out of Nemphy. Mega kill streak here for Aero on the Pugna. There'll be a Yule Scepter holding Matuma Man in place. They don't have the mana to follow this one up. NIP will simply look to clear out this set of racks, and they will find it indeed. Two full sets of racks down for the side of Forest. See, there's going to be a finger onto Limp. There's going to be the Bloodbright flying for it as well, but no, Limp looks himself out. He's going to be okay. Split up onto Unison Fan, but he's got the coverage of this Glimmer Cape, keeping him alive against this magical damage. Matuma Man, he's looking for the cleanup now. They will be able to take down the Venomancer. They're looking for Hansken and Sealkit as well. Matuma Man going straight into the Weak Doctor. That's the second kill. Can he find some more here? Matuma Man really wants to clean up. Error just standing there, draining him now. Now giving the life to Hansken, keeping him alive. Limp, he's juking this one out, making it very hard for Matuma Man to try and finish this one off. And Limp just blinks away here, who drops the coil onto Matuma Man. Matuma Man, he just can't get a break. He will go down. Has to buy back now. Forestry, their three heroes permanently down on the side. 30 seconds on the Omni Knight, 20 on the Lion, and 45 on the Leshrac. But what a fight there for NIP. And now Limp. Yule stepped onto Matuma Man. Matuma Man did indeed buy back. But Limp, he's just playing with him. He's just toying with him. Toying with Matuma Man. And I've got to say, man, Limp, I was saying at the beginning, you got to watch out for his play. In this game, I don't think it's been any exception. 17 kills, 19 assists. He might be able to add to that more here as well. Trixie goes in, does find the kill onto Aero with the help of Matuma Man. Limp, he really wants to do something here. He's got an orb in a few seconds. Pops out the Waning Rift. Trixie here, underground here. It's going to be okay. But, I mean, yeah, letting Limp have the puck, you've got to be a brave team to do that, Harney.
And the action is just not stopping. You're speaking nonstop. Because
it was just all, it's all
just
go.
No break. Huh? There's just no break. These two teams just fight each other every single second of this game. You just have pushes coming left and right. You just find these tower pushes. And if you're 4SC here, you just have to hope on NIP's mistakes.
Yeah.
But they're just not happening. NIP is playing very good this game. And you were mentioning Limp. He has a very good performance here on the park.
And the level 5 Dagon, 2,400 gold in the bank. Going to 80k net worth, and we're at this point now with the three cores of the side of NIP very much ahead of that of the side of 4SC. They're going to need something pretty spectacular to come back into this one as well. If we look at the graphs also, it's coming up to a 25,000 gold lead and a 20,000 XP lead here for the side of NIP. And Guardian Greaves now completed on your Pugna.
I'm generally not the biggest fan of the item, but he already had Mac Mana Boots, so It's all right. Does it really benefit him so much here? I guess it's pretty good against the Silence of Bloodseeker, so not too bad.
Yeah, I guess,
but
yeah.
It just doesn't work against stun.
Let's see what happens here. Nemphy leading the charge here for the side of 4SC. Might be caught out. Limp looking for the potential blink in. Has got that Yules. Has got that Dream Coil here. The orb forward will be there. Varlix just TP out. There's not really anything to stop that in time. As Lion TP's back to base, he's got to do something about this push from the creeps coming in on the bottom lane. But NIP, they're ready to try and finish this one. They want to try and end it down the top lane, look for the Mega Creeps. And it is indeed going to be that Manta Star coming out on Venomancer, as you were suggesting.
He did not split that Yasha. He did not split up that Sentry Yasha, though. I'm wondering what his thoughts are. Maybe he just wants to have raw sets. I'm not entirely against getting Sentry Yasha and Manta. But it makes sense having the Fusion Blade with a mana burn, working with illusions. I think it's an alright pickup.
Oh, Matuma Man in the sidelines. So he's going to get caught out. Bloodbright coming down. Rupture onto Yunus and Fan. The side of NMP, they have got the Tombstone down. Witch Doctor and Venomancer dropping very low. Guardian Angel coming out from the side of 4SC. They want to try and fight into this, but they've lost the Bloodseek. He's down for 85 seconds. Nemphy, he's being trapped up here by the Tombstone Zombies. He'll go down as well for a good minute. They lost the Witch Doctor, but he buys back straight away. Repel onto Trixie. He's going to help him. And Hansken forces himself forward there with a final decay to bring down Varlix. And GG is going to be called by the side of 4SC. The game ends 51-23, 52-23 for the side of NIP against 4ASC. And what an action-packed game that was, and what an action-packed series that was between these sides. But all in all, of course, as we were saying, spoilers, watch it, you know, hold your ears if you don't want to hear what's going on this qualifiers in regards to Alliance. But the game didn't matter. We know who's first. It is indeed going to be 4ASC coming out top of the group, and Ninjas in Pyjamas have cemented their position second in it all. So, I mean, that game, what did you think of it, Harney? Who were your standout performances, and why did it go wrong for the side of 4ASC that one?
On the side of 4ASC, if you lose the bottom lane like they did, I think it was a great play in the very start by Era, who decreed that totem, and then it resulted into two kills. But we see the scoreboard here, mm-hmm. and we see three performances by on the side of NIP here, with
yep.
Adrian, Era having 14-6, 26,
very good.
Then on Limb, 18-4, 21 on that puck, as well as Hanskin being 9-1 and 28 on the Undying. That's stellar performances. But overall, I would say that Puck, to me, seems to be the MVP of the series.
Yeah. I gotta say, I mean, yeah, every time that I've seen Limp, Ninjas in Pyjamas, of course, recently in the Dream League that I was working, every time that the Puck came out, I saw him lose a single game. I mean, his win rate percentage is very impressive on the hero. And you got to have some fairly hefty balls going into a draft and allowing them to get that hero on the side. And I think, obviously, going into the playoff stage of this TI qualifiers, I wouldn't be surprised if we see Puck being banned out a hell of a lot of time against the side of NIP, because it's just so strong for them.
I mean, particularly, it's not a very common pick these days in a mid
That's
position.
True.
I don't think he has had any changes, though. It's still as strong as it was before. And like you were mentioning, NIP seems to do very well with it. And if it's one of the core heroes, they should probably go further with it. They had a stellar performance this game with him playing that hero. But what can you say? This last game did not matter too much, like you were mentioning, but I'm just happy for my all two former teammates.
Yeah, I mean, it works out. Indeed, they've got the potential of going to TI, indeed, off the back of this one. And as we can see there, indeed, the final standings there for the group, as we were saying. Four anchors going through first position into the winner's bracket. And I believe this means, of course, second place starts off in the loser's bracket of the playoffs. So I think EU qualifier playoffs are going to be very exciting. Along with, of course, all the other regions playoffs that we've seen so far. But, well, that's it, Harney, for today. I believe Alliance versus PR has, well, indeed, we saw the standings. It must have finished. So that's it for EU qualifiers today. In terms of the other group, we've still got one more game. Twitch says Rap God Eminem is casting Dota. There we go. Thank you, Twitch chat. Goddamn Twitch chat. But indeed, there's going to be one more game of EU qualifiers, which I think, you know, plans at the moment. I think me and you might be casting it. London Conspiracy versus Vega, which has been rescheduled to tomorrow. I'm not too sure on a time. Production, do we know what time that match will be played? There we go. 12 CEST. On this stream. So guys, don't close this stream in 13 hours and 15 minutes
just,
from
just
now.
Just stay on it.
Just stay here. You know, just leave it open. It's going to be offline, but still, the Twitch chat never goes offline.
That's
so we know you guys in Twitch chat. You can stick around. You know, make some friends. You know, Twitch chat's a very friendly place. You know, great place to meet people. You know, you might even meet your future lover. You know, it's a fantastic place to hook up with some very nice birds. But that's it from me and Harney. Hopefully you've enjoyed the stream. Hopefully you've enjoyed the cast. You can catch us, of course, myself at ODPixel on Twitter. Where can they find you, Harney? Is it at?
At Kai Harney.
At Kai Harney. There we go. Enjoy the rest of your day. Enjoy the rest of your Dota. We'll see you guys soon.